this honor will never be forgotten. O Lord Almighty, you who examine the righteous and probe the heart and mind, let me see your vengeance upon me. For to you I have given my cause. Send to the Lord, give praise to the Lord. He rescues the life and the needy from the hands of the wicked. At first glance, this kind of passage is a little bit troubling for us because Jeremiah begins this section with the words, "O Lord, you deceived me." And last time I checked, God doesn't really deceive anyone, and this is true. The Hebrew, believe it or not, doesn't even say deceive. We just translate the Hebrew word katah into English as deceive to give it the forcefulness of Jeremiah's anguish. Jeremiah, the weeping prophet, laments to God that this is not what he bargained for. He didn't fully understand all of what proclaiming the word of God does, both to his hearers and to himself. Now he gets that it brings him heartache because the people he speaks to do not respect him. In fact, they ridicule him. Yet that same word that Jeremiah speaks from God, which gains him ears in the eyes of his peers, also gives him hope, gives him comfort. That's all what's embedded in this word, which we then translate as deceive. But the point of all this is that Jeremiah is troubled and he's lamented, and God allows Jeremiah needed it, as so many of us need from time to time, to vent, to air frustration as part of his processing of what all was in his head. And God did not stop him. God didn't say, "Now hold on a second, Jeremiah, you check your tone, young man." God can talk so that Jeremiah himself could arrive at the conclusion that God was still with him, and that God was still comforting him, and that God was still giving him hope. Jeremiah didn't need anyone to talk. He needed someone to crawl into the hole with him and be there until he was ready to come out. And we understand this because we hurt. If we look at our reading from Romans chapter 7 this morning, what's it all about? It's about the use of the law. And St. Paul can get kind of technical because St. Paul is complicated at times, which is why even when you get confused with all the "is this what it says" by your means, you still get the basic message that he's presenting without going that deep. Because he uses this illustration, marriage. Marriage is a wonderful and holy thing. But in a way that St. Paul uses it as an illustration, our minds can walk to the areas where there is hurt in marriage. Because nobody's marriage has always been imperfect. Adultery plagues so many marriages in so many ways, in various forms. Sometimes outright infidelity, sometimes in pornography, sometimes it's simply slandering your spouse's reputation. "Oh, my Lord, do you know what she did? Or do you know what he did? No. upon me that I have come to bring peace to the earth. I have not come to bring peace to the soul. Life here on earth is a painful thing. We all sin and we all hurt one another, and being a Christian does not magically make that hurt go away. Sometimes we can make the hurt worse because our families and friends laugh at us because of who we believe in, because of what we believe, and we lament and we cry and we crawl into our hole. And that's where the law puts us, in our hole, realizing that we are indeed fallen, pitiful, embarrassed, the people in need of redemption. We understand this, and we all understand this because we are in it. The problem is not that everyone who is down and out living in embarrassment has hope. We know who Jesus is. But how many out there still do not? Our Lord says in the last verse of our gospel text for this morning, in Matthew chapter 10, and whoever gives one of these little ones even a full cup of water because he is a disciple, truly, I say to you, he will find no means of using you. What children of God who need cool water are being placed before us? What children of God are in a hole of embarrassment where they're not sure how to explain what they're feeling? And they're embarrassed and need for us to be there with them, not necessarily to share our great pearls of wisdom, but to be a loving presence, to give them that cup of cool water when they've been crying hard and they're all worked up. What this means to death. It is to do so with death, the heart and mind of Jesus. Our Lord Jesus comes down from heaven and crawls into our little hole of despair, and he dwells among us. He listens to us. He hears our complaints. He hears our laments. And in ways and moments he alone knows how to use, he showed us his love. When we were in our darkest hour, he took hold of us and allowed himself to be lifted up to die in our place. He endures pain, he endures ridicule, he endures agony. All for us, all for you, all for me. He took our pain, he took our sin, he took everything that causes us to suffer from the perfect peace of our Father in heaven. And by his death on the cross, he frees to walk as one's home. Hope that someday, when we close our eyes and breathe our last, we will be with our Lord in heaven. We'll be out of our despair. That's the message that we get to share with one another, my brothers and sisters. That is the message that we get to share with those who are troubled, those who, for whatever reason, need to be listened to. It is my prayer that each and every one of us will be willing to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ to them, because we ourselves have also received, and may we continue to be a presence of his love until that day.